I start to forget what I learned in the earlier sections such as math, probability, ethics, engineering economics, and so on by the time I reach the end of the specification. For example, software, computers, digital systems, and so on. And sometimes, even when I reach the middle of the specification, such as electronics or linear systems or power systems, I feel like I'm forgetting what I learned in math and some of the earlier sections. So what should I do? I feel like I'm not making any progress, because as soon as I progress on to the middle of the specification or the later half of the specification, I would have to go back. And if I choose to keep going forward through the middle of the specification and reach the end of the specification, I feel like I don't have enough confidence, or maybe I'm doing something wrong. The scenario that I just described is one of the main reasons why students procrastinate in taking the FE Electrical and Computer exam and other FE exams, I'm pretty sure for the same reason. And even when they get started with the FE exam preparation, they realize that as soon as they reach the end of the specification, sometimes the middle of the specification, they're starting to forget. And it causes a lot of frustration and disappointment on the part of the student. In this video, we are going to tackle this issue head on and try and come up with a strategy which a lot of my students who are enrolled in my FE Electrical and Computer exam preparation course, as well as a P-Power exam preparation course, students who are using my study guides and practice exams, they deploy this technique successfully and are able to overcome this challenge. But before we jump into the content, I would like to request you to like this video and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already done so. The answer to this problem of knowledge or concept retention when it comes to FE Electrical and Computer exam, as well as a PE Power exam, is spaced repetition. I'm going to repeat, spaced repetition. So what is spaced repetition? I'm pretty sure that during your college, university days, during your high school days, and during your secondary or elementary school days as well, you might have consciously or subconsciously deployed this strategy. We are going to break down the concept of spaced repetition in the context of FE Electrical and Computer exam preparation in three simple stages. Stage number one is the first round of review. Now, the assumption is that you're making use of effective exam preparation resources while doing your first round of review. We have 17 sections to tackle. I have a separate video on how you can go about tackling the 17 FE Electrical and Computer exam specification sections. But in the first round of review, essentially the assumption is that you're making use of good exam preparation resources that are helping you walk through step by step through all of these 17 sections. Now, in the first round of review, you're supposed to take your time. You're supposed to go through the specification, understand the theory, understand the concepts, do a lot of practice problems. So what a lot of my students do, those who are enrolled in my FE Electrical on-demand course, they actually go through the lectures where I explain the theory and the concepts. I do a bunch of practice problems in the lectures. They actually stop during the lectures and they try and attempt those problems themselves. And then at the end of the lectures, there are quizzes. Those quizzes are supposed to help reinforce the understanding and give you some additional practice problems. At the end of every section, say mathematics, probability, ethics, engineering economics, there's a mini exam. The mini exam is timed. It has a certain higher level of difficulty, and it is there to sort of do a comprehensive testing on the section that you just basically went through for the lectures. You went through all the lectures, and now you should have a good understanding of what that entire section is all about. And the mini exam basically tests you on that. Students who are using the course as well as the study guide, you can see the study guide in the background, they deploy the course and the study guide together. So when they're going through the lectures, the quizzes, the mini exams, they're doing the relevant problem sets in the study guide as well. So they continue doing this for a period of 2 to 3 months, sometimes 1 month. I have a separate video where we basically go over how you can determine the timeline for the FE Electrical and Computer exam preparation depending on your own scenario. So let's assume that the first round of review, you go through this process without actually going back. You are just sequentially tackling each and every section by section, and making use of an effective exam preparation resource, and you are done with 17 sections. At this point in time, you're not looking back. You're just moving forward and not worrying about whether you're able to retain the information, whether you are forgetting about the formulas or the concepts. So by the time you hit the 17 sections, you've basically done an in-depth first round of review. Stage two is strategic review, or the second round of review. In order to execute this stage, we have to have a list of all the weak areas that you must compile when you're going through your first round of review. So let's say if you're using the on-demand course, you're going lecture by lecture, and if you find a particular lecture which is challenging, I want you to make a note of that in your notebook, in your personal diary, or on a spreadsheet, or whichever resource or whichever tool you're using. If you're using the study guide, then maybe make a note on individual problems that you're finding difficult, or the problem sets that you're finding difficult. The idea is that by the time you're done with first round of review, you have a list of all the weak areas by being very honest and transparent to yourself that, okay, these are the topics that I really don't get a good hang of. It could be Norton theorem, it could be Bayes theorem, it could be JFET analysis, BJT analysis, it could be a certain topic within software, a certain algorithm, and so on and so forth. So whatever it is, by the end of first round of review, I want you to have that list of weak areas. And this is what most of my students who are enrolled in my course and are using my resources, they do that. And in the stage two, which is strategic review, they basically go back, give themselves a couple of weeks, maybe 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks, depending on how much time you have, depending on how weak you think you are in those areas. Then they basically dive back into those concepts and do another in-depth review of only the weak areas. It is practically not possible to review the whole thing. And you can see that by doing that, we have already increased our level of knowledge retention and review significantly, because it's the weak areas that are going to give you trouble during your exam preparation and also on the exam day. So if you have a chance to patch them up another time, right after the first round of review, in the second round of review, if you can patch them up as well, then you can see that your level of exam preparation is going to be far better. It's going to be far improved, and you're going to feel much more confident about your exam readiness. But this stage cannot be executed until and unless you're keeping track of your weaknesses in stage number one. So stage one took us anywhere between 1 month to 2 months or 2.5 months, maybe even 3 months. Stage two takes most of the students anywhere between 2 weeks to 4 weeks, maybe 5 weeks. And now we are in the third and the final stage, which is stage three. I call this the practice exam stage. So far, we haven't really looked at any of the practice exams. Our focus has been to do in-depth reviews during the first cycle and strategic review during second cycle. But when it comes to stage three, it's all about practice exams. I want you to allocate at least 2 to 3 weeks for practice exams. Because if you think about it, in any sport, whenever the sports person or the athletes, when they're practicing, whether it's soccer, whether it's basketball, baseball, or any other sport for that matter, they actually have a routine where they actually practice certain elements or certain skills. For example, if you're talking about soccer, then they might be doing cardiovascular exercises one day, they might be doing weight training the other day, they might be doing strategic training the other day, and then they might be doing sprints, they might actually be doing long passes, short passes, penalty kicks, and so on and so forth. But essentially, it's only on the game day that they're able to bring everything together. And that's why when teams are preparing for a big tournament, they actually do a lot of warm-up games. And the whole reason is that they want to bring all the skill set together so that they can improve their performance. And that's the whole idea about the practice exams. The entire reason that I want you to be doing the practice exams, well, there are two reasons. A lot of students focus on maybe the first reason quite extensively, but it's really the second reason that helps you the most. The first reason is that you want to be able to determine your exam readiness, whether you're ready to take the exam or not. So students take a look at it as during my calls with my students who enroll in my course, I do a 15-minute Zoom call with them, and I tell them that the example is like a crystal ball, right? Students look at the practice exams like a crystal ball, whether it's going to tell them that they're passing the exam or failing the exam, right? That's maybe it's a fair utilization, but not a complete utilization of the practice exams. In my opinion, practice exams are there to help you identify any gaps, any weak areas, any blind spots a few weeks before the actual exam. So let's say you do practice exam number one, which you can see in the background, practice exam number two, practice exam number three, the NCEES sample practice exam. And within my course, I have a computer simulated practice exam for all of the students. They actually do it once they're done with the course. So let's say each practice exam shows that you have about 15 to 20 problems, which is pretty normal. On a 110 question exam, if you are within the 80 out of 110 range, that's an amazing performance. Even 70 out of 110, it is a very respectable performance. But you have to, again, just like the second round of review, now focus on those 40, 30, or 20 problems that the practice exam identified for you that you're still weak on. So the idea is not to just take a step back and send me an email, Wasim, what do you think that on your practice exam number one, if I scored certain percentage, am I going to pass the exam or not? And this is such a common email that I get from students all the time. And my response is that whatever that percentage is, don't get fixated on that. You have to now look at the balance of the percentage, whether it's 65, so you have to look at the remaining 35% that you got wrong so that you can fix it up. And when I get an email saying that, okay, on this particular exam, I did 75%, let's say, you think I'm gonna pass? My response is the same. For this particular practice exam now, you have to look at the remaining 20 or 25% that you need to fix. So let's say you do three practice exams by giving yourself 3 weeks, then you are able to focus on 20 or 30 or 15 or 10 questions from each practice exam and fix them up before or address the concepts using the resources that you're using, whether it's a course, whether it's your own lecture notes, whether you are finding the resources, doing the research on Google or YouTube, whichever resources you are using, then go back to them and fix those areas one last time before the actual exam. Now, when you put all of these three stages together, it is spaced repetition, because what you did in the first round of review was go through the entire thing. Essentially, you repeated it for the very first time. In your stage two, you repeated it the second time, but very strategically, focusing again on areas of concern. And in the stage three, we made use of the practice exams in order to give us a nice and fast-tracked review one last time before the actual exam of things that we must take a look at. And when you combine all these three, we have essentially done three repetitions. The repetition number one, you can call it repetition zero, repetition two in stage two, and repetition three, very strategic and even fine, like much more granular in stage three. So when you combine all this, and this is what I recommend a lot of my students, in fact, in the very first lecture, as I mentioned, that is advice I give to students when they enroll in my course and we do a one-on-one Zoom call, that this is how you gotta look at this exam and not worry about whether your memory is strong, whether you're able to retain information or not. It is a strategy that will help you. It is a very streamlined and effective method of making sure that whatever you're learning, you're frequently revisiting in a very efficient manner so that you don't have to worry about whether you're going to be able to retain that or not. You can just focus on the task at hand. We're sort of working in modules over here, right? When you're doing the first round of review, you're not worried about how you're going to repeat it or how we're going to revise it or review it again. When we're doing the second round of review, we have that list that we're going through, and essentially that list is going to help us achieve our goal, the list of weak areas that is specifically applicable to you and you only. And then in the third round of review, we are making use of another resource, the practice exams, and those practice exams are giving us a last opportunity to essentially do a fast track review. And this should greatly improve your knowledge retention and chances of passing the exam.